country, it says majority rules. We are 80% of the majority in this. We are 80% in this county. And we have the right to rule this county. We have the right to rule this county, and we're going to rule it. I don't care how poor we are and how black we are, we're going to govern this county.
Stokely Carmack and Colton Cox and others who got together and told us, according to the Alabama law, if we didn't like what the Democratic Party was doing in our county or the Republican Party, we could form our own political organization, and it could become a political party.
George Wallace was then head of the Alabama Democratic Party. The Democratic Party was racist. Its symbol at that time had a white rooster, and it had the words of white supremacy. That was the official emblem of the Democratic Party of Alabama. So here it would be easy for us to tell our people, hey, look, this party is not for us. We need our own party.
The new political party was named the Lowndes County Freedom Organization, but it became better known by the symbol it chose, a Black Panther.
And then when we chose that symbol, it was a Black Panther, then many of the people in our county started saying we were violent during that time. You know, now you got a violent group in Lowndes County who is turning out, who's going to start killing white folks. But it wasn't that. It was a political, just a symbol to our organization that we was here to stay and we were going to do whatever needed to be done. So by
everybody was excited because they said, well, they have the rooster, which represents the Democratic Party, the elephant, which represents the Republican Party. Why can't we have a black cat to represent us? Everybody knows how a cat looked, and we were excited because we knew that if a person couldn't read and write, they sure knew the difference between a cat, an elephant, and a rooster.
SNCC went door to door and farm to farm, explaining to first-time voters the rules for taking part in the Lowndes County primary.
Now, the law says that you can vote in ours and also vote in the Democratic primary, which has to be held on the same day, according to the law. Mm-hmm. So what we'll have to do is vote on one and not the other. So if you want to vote for our candidates, for sheriff, for tax assessor, tax collector, coroner, and the school board, then you have to vote for us.
If we are going to be free, we will have to suffer for that freedom. We will have to sacrifice for it.
But I'm not going to beg the white man for anything that I deserve. I'm going to take it.
Mississippi ain't nothing but a bunch of racists, and the only people who can stop them are the black folk in Mississippi. Now we've got to make this march our march. This has got to be the march for the black people in Mississippi, and the only way we can make that our march is that we got to go into every little place and get every black man and black woman, black boy and black girl out who's not afraid, and let's march and let's make this our Mississippi.
Woody Ricks was sent out his head as the advanced scouts, and sometimes he could have as many as 20 to 40, as we grew bigger, even 20 or 40 people in his direction to spread out. And his task was to take them, spread them out to plantations, speak to the sharecroppers, tell them the march was coming through, but to throw out black power and to give little black power speeches to get the reaction. I think about three nights before Greenwood, because I think it was decided where's the best place for us to launch it. About three nights before Greenwood, I remember about 2 o'clock in the morning, Ricks came back and he was giving a report, and Cleve Sellers was sitting next to me, I remember. And Ricks was saying, we ought to drop it now. The people are ready for it. It's nicer than the other day, and they dropped their hose, you know. And I said to Cleve, I said, you know, you sent the wrong man out because we need a clear analysis here, and this man is given to exaggerations.
What are you wrong?
Ricks had everybody primed. He said, just get to your speech. We're going against freedom now. We're going for black power. Don't hit too much on freedom now, but hit the need for power. So we built up on the need for power. And just when I got there, before I got it, Ricks was there saying, hit him now, hit him now. I kept saying, give me time, give me time. When we finally got him, we dropped it, black power. Of course, they had been primed, and they responded immediately. But I myself, to be honest, I didn't expect that enthusiastic response.
We want black power. What do you want?
Let me say first that this march is nonviolent. It is a nonviolent expression of our determination to be free. This is the principle of the march, and certainly we intend to keep this march nonviolent.
Mr. Carmichael, are you as committed to the nonviolent approach as Dr. King is?
No, I'm not.
Why aren't you?
Well, I just don't see it as a way of life. I never have. Now, I also realize that no one in this country is asking the white community in the South to be nonviolent, and that, in a sense, is giving them a free license to go ahead and shoot us at will.
We don't want anybody to move. The time for running has come to an end. You tell them white folk in Mississippi that all the dead niggas are dead. You tell them they shot all the rabbits, they're gonna deal with the men.
Of means against his executioner in fighting for a position of equality. After he tries a number of means and they do not work, he then begins to imitate the means by which his executioner kept him down. That is usually through force and violence. He says, and then they begin to use it against them, breaking the one taboo that they've never been able to break, hitting back against their executioners, so that you ought not to be upset. If we are violent, the United States taught us very well how to be violent.
The question of whether or not violence is going to be used is not a question for the black community. It's a question for white America. Because white America is the one who has used violence. For 400 years, we have been the recipients of violence. We have never lynched. We have never shot. We've never burnt a church. We've never beaten people. We've never taken them to jail. That is the question for white America. The real question is, can she civilize herself before we get ready to civilize her? And we're just not concerned about the Vietnam War per se. We are concerned about the survival of black people in this country. And that we cannot survive if we go fight some yellow man in Vietnam who ain't never called us nigger.
America was deeply entrenched in Vietnam. War overseas. Poverty at home. Already taken those risks. They urged King to join them.
He called me in Atlanta. He said, what you doing? He said, tomorrow's Sunday. He said, you're going to be a good Christian and go to church? I said, well, like a good heathen, I'm going to work for the people. I got office paperwork. I'll be working since 6 o'clock in the morning. He said, well, I want you to come to church. I said, come to church? Where? He said, Ebenezer. I said, what's happening there? He said, I'm preaching. I said, well, you know, okay, I can always come here. You preach, you know, because even though I don't believe in your stuff, you make me tap my feet, you know, we joked. And he said, well, I really want you to come tomorrow. I said, okay, I'll come. He said, because tomorrow I'm going to make my statement against the war in Vietnam. And I think between us there must have been 35 seconds of silence. And then I said to him, I'm going to be on the front seat of your church.
They seem to forget that before I was a civil rights leader. I answered a call which left the Spirit of the Lord upon me and anointed me to preach the gospel. During the early days of my ministry, I read the Apostle Paul saying, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And I decided then that I was going to tell the truth as God revealed it to me. I don't know about you. I ain't going to study war no more.
We're here to celebrate Brother Huey P. Newton's birthday. We're not here to celebrate it as Huey Newton, the individual, but as Huey Newton, part and parcel of black people wherever we are on the world today. And so in talking about Brother Huey Newton tonight, we have to talk about the struggle of black people, not only in the United States, but in the world today, and how he becomes part and parcel of that struggle, how we move on so that our people will survive America. Now, why is it necessary for us to talk about the survival of our people? Many of us feel, many of our generation feel, that they're getting ready to commit genocide against us. Now, many people say that's a horrible thing to say about anybody. But if it is a horrible thing to say, then we should do as Brother Malcolm says, we should examine history. The birth of this nation was conceived in the genocide of the red man. Genocide of the red man. Of the red man. In order for this country to come about, the honky had to completely exterminate the red man, and he did it. And he did it. He did it. And he did it where he does not even feel sorry, but he romanticizes it by putting it on television with cowboy and Indians. Cowboy and Indians.
If you do not think he's capable of committing genocide against us, check out what he's doing to our brothers in Vietnam. Check out what he's doing in Vietnam. We must develop an undying love as is personified in Brother Huey P. Newton. If we do not do that, we will be wiped out. Our slogan will become, first, our people, then, and only then, me and you as individuals. Our people first. Our people first. The concept of a black man is one who recognizes his cultural, his historical, and the roots of his great ancestors who were the greatest warriors on the face of this earth. Africans. 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 Many of our people's minds have been whitewashed. If a Negro comes up to you and you turn your back on him, he's got to run to the honky. We're going to take time and patience with our people because they're ours. They're ours. All of the Uncle Toms, we're going to sit down and we're going to talk. And when they slap, we're going to bow. And when they slap, we're going to bow. And we're going to try to bring them home. And if they don't come home, we're going to off them. That's all. We have to recognize who our major enemy is. The major enemy is not your brother, flesh of your flesh, and blood of your blood. The major enemy is the honky and his institutions of racism. That's the major enemy. That is the major enemy. A lot of people in the bourgeoisie tell me they don't like Rap Brown when he says, I'm going to burn the country down. But every time Rap Brown says, I'm going to burn the country down, they get a poverty program. They get a poverty program. A lot of people say to me, we don't like the Black Panthers for self-defense, walking around with guns. I tell you now, if the hunkies in San Francisco take off the fighters who happen to represent the Black Panthers for self-defense, ain't nobody in this community prepared to fight right now. Everybody gets off. And that's what we have to understand today. So that everything goes out the window, we talk about survival. That's all. They can cut all that junk about poverty program, education, housing, welfare. We talking about survival, and brothers and sisters, we gonna survive America. We gonna survive America. We gonna survive America. We need each other. We have to have each other for our survival. We have to have each other. From the revolutionaries to the conservatives, a black united front is what we're about. A black united front is what we're about. I want to read a statement that Brother Huey P. Newton wrote yesterday when I saw him in jail. He says, as the racist police escalate the war in our communities against black people, we reserve the right to self-defense and maximum retaliation. Understand this concept. Understand this concept. When they off Brother Malcolm, we did nothing. If they off Brother Huey, we got to retaliate. We got to retaliate. We must retaliate. We must fight for our humanity. It is our humanity that is at stake. All we say, Brother Huey will be set free or else.
But it falls down again. Some of us are in the bar African. All of this was based on ignorance, and it's arrogant ignorance. I saw a sister, you know, we put on one of these posters, you know, we had a poster saying bombs in Africa could get bombs in America. Hands off Libya, Angola, and Nicaragua. It's a fact. It's a political fact. Come on. You think that some of us know that Africa is our mother? You throw bombs at our mother, Jack. We got to throw bombs at you. It's as simple as that. Ain't no question out here. And there are 50 million Africans in this country. 50 million. Is that the FBI? They ain't none of the chumps. They ain't fooling nobody. They could even catch Patricia Hurst. She had to give up, but they have to give up. See the difference. We can certainly come here and tell you about Africa's great contributions to humanity, which are great. Everyone knows that. Anyone knowing anything about world history must respect Africa. I saw a man the other day, he called himself a born-again Christian. Racist, the core he was. He was a born-again Christian. Well, see, I know that if he knows anything about Christianity, he's got to respect Africa and just about bow down to her. You understand? Because when everybody was trying to kill Jesus Christ, the only place he found refuge was in Africa. It was Africa.
King was a preacher, but he was not a jag-leg preacher. King was a preacher, but he was a true Christian. Martin Luther King understood that to be a preacher didn't mean that you come to drive Cadillacs. Martin Luther King understood that to be a preacher didn't mean you come to make money. Martin Luther King understood that to be a preacher you came to be concerned about the poor. Martin Luther King understood what Christianity was. He wasn't no jack-leg preacher talking about no majority nonsense. King was a Christian. He came to give his life for the poor. He came to give his life for the wretched. He came to give his life for the downtrodden. And with this you must understand. When King came to Atlanta, Georgia, when Africans in Atlanta, Georgia saw a white man walking on the sidewalk, they had to get off. You have to pay the same money as a bus and get on the back of the bus and be insulted to boot. You had to go and buy things in the back door. Yes, and every time you saw a white man, you were scared to death. And King came to say, this man is just like you. God made him just like he made you. You don't have to be afraid of him. The only man you must be afraid of is God. Dig it, and he ain't God. And he's a long way from it. They came to America. They had a potato famine created by British imperialism. The Italians left. They came. All of them came on their own free will. Some came because they were running from religious intolerance. Some came because there were economic problems. But they left of their free will. Not one of us left of our free will. We weren't running from nothing in Africa when we came here, Jack. Matter of fact, the only thing we were running from was the slave catcher. Yet we are ashamed of Africa. We... You leave your house, somebody come and steal you from your house, take you to their house, and you become ashamed of your house. Somebody else runs from his house, and he loves his house more than you love your house. Capitalism is a vicious system. It must be struggled against on every level. It makes you even less than a dog. Even a dog, if you steal a dog from his house and treat him bad for 400 years, as soon as he gets a chance, he's gonna run away. He ain't even got a swim home. We who have been suffering in America for 400 years love America, don't care about Africa. We say we love it more than any other group. We speak the truth here. We're revolutionaries. We don't play with King. We love King. We don't play with King. We're doing exactly what King would be doing if you're alive today. We're fighting the capitalist system without pity and without mercy. And the only difference we have with King is a tactical difference, not a philosophical difference. King will only use nonviolence. We will use any means necessary.
They've already begun. Of course, when we say pan-Africanism, we understand that it means that all people who look like us are Africans.
Yes.
When we say pan-Africanism, there's a basic understanding here. That Africans who find themselves outside of Africa were pulled out of Africa against their will, that their labor was built, used to build other countries, and that they must be conscious of the responsibility that their only nation is Africa. Yeah. That's why Africa is never mentioned. Even when presenting history to us by those who are pan-Africanists, they will try to hide it. For example, those of you who are aware of the name Franz Fanon, who know anything about Franz Fanon, must know that Franz Fanon is a sterling Pan-Africanist. Yet nowhere will you see the name Pan-Africanism attached to the name Franz Fanon. Maybe Franz Fanon, revolutionary communist. Franz Fanon, great fighter. Franz Fanon, everything except Franz Fanon, Pan-Africanist.
Harriet Tubman showed us that one takes struggle to the grave. And if Frederick Douglass said, where there's no struggle, there's no progress, and we must make progress till we die, listen to this, struggle is eternal. Well, speaking of conscious men and women, a stupid man, a stupid woman, may think that she who consumes the most and produces the least is a successful man or woman. This is acting like an animal. Animals cannot produce, they can only consume. A conscious human being must know that they must produce more than they consume, because they have to leave something for those who come after them. Their
Therefore, the conscious student is looking to produce more than they consume, looking again to live in truth. We say the truth is that the capitalist system lies to the people about their history. Therefore, it is the job of the conscious student to find the people's history. Our party, the All African People's Revolutionary Party, is a revolutionary party. We are a revolutionary party. Our objective is Pan-Africanism, the total liberation and unification of Africa under scientific socialism. We are socialists. We know you're against it, but we're not worried about you. You don't know nothing about it. Matter of fact, American capitalism confuses you so much you don't even want to know. The other day I was talking about socialism. A man said to me, Brother Kwame, you still talking about socialism? I said, still talking about it. He said, yeah, you're a socialist? I said, of course I am. How come? Because I'm intelligent. What you think? He said, but Brother Kwame, you didn't hear about it? Hear about what? It died. What? Socialism. Where? You didn't hear about it? I must have been sleeping. No! You hear about what happened in Russia with Gorbachev? I said, oh, that's just betrayal, brother. Don't let them confuse you. No. Socialism is finished. I said, it can never be finished. He said, but all of them, they all finished. They themselves, they belong. I said, you don't judge a system by its adherents. You judge it by its principles. Capitalism will confuse him. Yeah, he's judging socialism by socialists. I told him, you don't judge socialism by socialists, you judge it by its principles. He said, well, if you don't judge it by that, how you gonna judge it? I asked him, do you judge Christianity by Christians? Well, deform your thinking. You don't judge Christianity by Christians, you judge it by its principles. We don't even judge Christianity by the Pope. And certainly not by the preachers we got, because most of them are pimping for Cadillacs.
Present to you a memorial tribute to a great, I must say, a very honorable brother, Brother Kwame Ture, who has traveled across the waters, as we say, on November 15, 1998, in Conakry, Guinea, West Africa. Brother Ture was 57 years old. Brother Kwame Ture, a Pan-Africanist, nationalist, a fighter, and among other things, one that I can say left a legacy for many of us to follow and to carry on. But first of all, let us at Insight,
I hear you,
and on behalf of my family, to his mother and his family, and the All African People's Revolutionary Party, we, the members of Insight and my family, extend our condolences, our prayers, and our libations to you all. So therefore, we dedicate this program to the legacy of Brother Kwame Ture, a first of a series of programs, by all means, because we know that we cannot capture nor can we identify the real source of the history and the accomplishment of Kwame Ture in a one-hour program. So we will be continuing to have several programs and in-depth on the effect and the legacy of Brother Kwame Ture. But in his memory and his accomplishments and struggle,
the total liberation of African people at home and abroad. We begin by first of all saying the Kwaba, being welcome, and to our valued guest today, Brother Yao Yambo, organizer for the AAPRP here in Georgia. A Kwaba to Insight.
Thank you.
Brother Yao Yambo. First of all, I know on behalf of your party, we are very grateful, and we say Madasi for you coming here to share some of the thoughts and ideas of Brother Kwame. First of all, Brother Yao Yambo, tell us something about your participation. First of all, you as an organizer for the AARP, begin telling us how you got involved with the AARP.
Well, I got involved in the African People Revolutionary Party on June 10th, 1978. Me and Sister Ngozi Okorafor, who was a sister who at the University of Fort Valley State, who was in Players Guild, saw a leaflet that Brother Kwame Ture was going to be in Atlanta. Uh-huh. At the time, his name then was still known as Stokely Carmichael. Okay. So she called Brother Makasa, who at the time then, most people know him as Willie Ricks during this time, and wanted to know how could we bring him to Fort Valley State. So it was worked out, and Brother Kwame came to Fort Valley State and lectured on Pan-Africanism and the need for organization and the need for African people to be free. Mm-hmm. And at this time, I joined the All African People Revolutionary Party ranks, and I've been in the party organizing to organize the mass of our people throughout the world since that time.
You have a really long and distinguished history in organizing activating African people throughout the world. For you, when you first met Kwame, well, first of all, did you meet Kwame Ture in the political sense, or you first became friends with him or associated with him?
I first met Kwame from a political aspect when I first met Kwame coming into the party. But as years went on, I became the program coordinator of the chapter of Georgia, and I was organizing Kwame Ture recruitment drive throughout Georgia. So me and Kwame had the opportunity to spend a lot of time together moving throughout Georgia for a week or 10 days at a time every year. And plus I had opportunities of being in with Kwame on other occasions in different places in the U.S. and in other places in the world. So, you know, we became not only comrades, most of all, we became also friends, so.
Share with us. I mean, now this was back in the 70s. You're talking about in the height of what so-called civil rights period.
Yes.
Just for a second, what was it like, particularly, you know, being involved in that situation then?
It was very exciting during this time of knowing Kwame and come to hear Kwame lecture on the need for organization and the need for Africans to struggle to free our people. It was very exciting, and I remember Kwame saying that people probably thought he was crazy for some of the things that he was saying, because he was so far-fetched, because these are the things that the capitalist society do not teach you or say to you about organizing your people, about we are Africans, nothing but Africans, you know. Or even at this time, I think we was Black Americans or something like this, of this nature and stuff, right. You know. So Kwame always struggled to raise the political consciousness of the masses of our people constantly, mm-hmm. all the time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was always very exciting to meet Kwame from a political aspect, because Kwame was principled. And if we look back at Kwame as his struggle in the 60s, once Kwame joined organization, Kwame never left organization. Kwame might have went from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee,
right.
SNCC,
yeah.
To the Freedom Democratic Party, to the Black Panther Party, to the All African People Revolutionary Party. But we can definitely see that once Kwame joined the organization, the struggle for his people, he never put it down until he died on November 15th.
Yeah, well, that that we see it was a continual process that he had, and it seems that, if we can say this, from each organization, he kind of grew, you know, his knowledge, you know, his philosophy, intensity, the purpose. Many things became clearer, you know, if you follow the path from I mean, SNCC to the Freedom Fighters to the Black Panthers and finally into the All African People Revolutionary Party. As you grew, growing, you know, your friends and whatnot, what changes did you see at that time, or were you able to see the change then or rather later on?
Well, we know that changes, there's constant changes. We know that there's two types of changes, evolutionary changes and revolutionary changes.
Go ahead.
And we know that when we come to look at the evolutionary change that was set in process to make a revolutionary change by Brother Kwame Ture, mm-hmm. had a great impact upon Africans and non-Africans all over the world. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we can surely say by Brother Kwame Ture that he was one of the greatest Pan-Africanists who ever lived. That Kwame, as a Pan-Africanist, went more places in the world where African people are living at to discuss the need for Pan-Africanism, mm-hmm. that is to say, the total liberation and unification of Africa under scientific socialism, and the necessity for organization, and the necessity for ideology. Mm-hmm. We know in the civil rights movement that that's just what it was, the movement that people was split on their positions of struggle, that is to say, ecological struggle.
Right.
We can see that Kwame struggled through the civil rights movement, even at this time that SNCC was trying to organize the people to vote. Yeah, but they was also trying to organize the people to become self-sufficient, self-sustaining. We know that he grew from SNCC to understand the need for a party. And that's what come with the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party with Sister Fannie Lou Hamer
right.
during this time in Mississippi. But we understand that our people needed a party.
Mm-hmm.
We must have a party because we know that the Democratic Party, not a Republican Party, was a party that represents African people's interests.
What effect did Kwame Ture have on the party at that time, the Freedom of the National Party?
Well, at this particular time, you know, that Kwame have always been progressive. He have always come to push the people to a higher level of political development, of consciousness of our people's struggle.
Mm-hmm.
So Kwame understood that the national struggle inside of the U.S. among African people was a struggle that needed to be dealt with. But he also understood that we as a people needed a party. He also understood that as Africans in the U.S. could never be free until Africa is free. And so Kwame was always searching for a higher level of political consciousness. And when you come to ask Kwame Ture a question, Kwame always give you political education is the answer. Because Kwame was always reading, becoming mm-hmm. more politically educated
mm-hmm.
every day. And Kwame was real sharp. And if anybody know anything about Kwame Ture, mm-hmm. know Kwame was sharp.
Well, the choice of being a Pan-Africanist and the civil rights. In those days, did it ever occur to you all, I mean, to, you know, to choose one or the other, or would you automatically be drawn to the inevitable, you know, Pan-Africanist theory?
Well, you know, when Kwame was involved in the civil rights movement, you know, even during the Vietnam, hell no, we won't go, in the 60s, a lot of European organizations, communist parties, jumped on the bandwagon.
Mm-hmm.
And people tried to want Kwame to become a Marxist-Leninist. Kwame had this problem because even though he wasn't European, he was African.
Right.
So at this time, he had great opportunity to meet Kwame Nkrumah, not Secretary at this particular time.
Uh-huh.
But he knew that he wasn't a Marxist-Leninist. Matter of fact, I can remember... one morning, me between Kwame Ture, we was on our way from Fort Valley, Georgia to Savannah, Georgia. It's mm-hmm. a 3-hour ride to the university there. He was had a speaking engagement there. Mm-hmm. And he was telling me about the time when he met Ho Chi Minh.
Okay.
He was saying that, you know, Ho Chi Minh was trying to get him to be a Marxist Lenin.
Ho Chi Minh, who at that time was the leader of
the Vietnamese Communist Party.
Communist Party.
Right. And right. He said that, you know, that he couldn't be a Marxist Lenin because he was African.
Okay.
You know, he said even Ho Chi Minh told him at the time, was really shocked him, that I tell you what then, you go back to the U.S. and organize all them Africans there, and y'all go back to Africa and stop fighting me.
Okay. That was his, and you know, that's ironic because
the woman told me about all the problems and trouble that he had even going to Vietnam to meet with Ho Chi Minh during this time.
Right.
Kwame said when he got his passport, his first passport, there was a bunch of places on the back of his passport that he couldn't go.
Right.
You know, he couldn't go to places in Africa like Guinea. He couldn't go to Egypt. He couldn't go to Algeria. He couldn't go to Mali.
He couldn't go to Libya.
That's not Africa. Right. He couldn't go to Libya. He couldn't go to Cuba. He couldn't go to Soviet Union.
Right.
You know, but one of the places he could go was China. So he went to China, and he was going to leave China and try to catch a flight
to Vietnam,
to Cuba,
up to Cuba,
and then leave mm-hmm. Cuba and try to go into the Soviet Union.
Mm-hmm.
But when he got to China, Mrs. Du Bois sent for him to have dinner with him, her in the restaurant. He said he didn't know Mrs. Du Bois, know he was alive, much less in China.
Yeah, you told, you referring to
Miss Shirley Du Bois, Dr. W.B. Du Bois' wife.
Willow, right.
She asked Kwame, how would he like to meet Kwame Nkrumah? He said, I would give my life arm to meet Kwame Nkrumah.
Is that right?
Right, so that was his first chance to meet Kwame Nkrumah.
Oh, so you told Kwame Nkrumah.
He said, you know, he left for China and then flew into Cuba, and he was finna fly from Cuba to Soviet Union to catch a flight from the Soviet Union to Vietnam.
Right.
But he said when he left Cuba on his way to the Soviet Union on a passenger plane, mm-hmm. a teletype came across the wire in Cuba. The state struck a Carmichael passport when he got off the plane. Cuba turned the passenger plane around in the air and went back to Cuba, took Kwame off the plane, put him on a military plane, flew non-stop from Cuba to the Soviet Union flying from Soviet Union into Vietnam.
Wow.
And
okay.
So the show, you know, the CIA have been on Kwame for a long
yes,
time.
Yes, yes. And it's ironic that you mentioned that because, you know, many of our leaders have been stopped like that, you know, by not allowing them to use their passports and,
right.
you know what I mean, prohibiting them. But one other thing. And then we should be getting some calls soon. But who do you think helped influence his philosophy? Or let me put it this way. How many of the people can you mention that had an influence on his philosophy?
Well, I think a lot of people had a lot of influence on Kwame's life, from his struggle. Dealing with it is his biological family, his mom and his aunt and his sisters, them. And also, I think, you know, during the 60s movement, you know, that Malcolm, Elijah Muhammad, Fannie Lou Hamer, Sister Ella Baker,
okay.
Sojourner Truth, Patrice Lumumba, but I think Kwame Nkrumah, Sekou Touré, had the greatest influence upon Kwame Ture's life.
Right.
In the direction of moving towards Pan-Africanism and understanding the need to organize African peoples on a worldwide basis.
On a worldwide basis.
Versus just looking inside the U.S. You know, a lot of times, you know, Kwame be on a speaking engagements, you know, when it comes time to question and answer section, you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, Kwame, in 1968, you ran to Africa, you understand? Kwame went to Africa in 1969 and 1970. He was in Guinea-Conakry, and the Portuguese attacked Guinea Portuguese, and Kwame had to go to Armstrong and in Guinea-Conakry.
Right, right.
You know, so Kwame used to ask them, you know, how do you say I run? And you say I ran, you know.
Well,
I run too, you understand?
Yeah, well.
Because people have to understand, even today, a lot of people, especially Africans probably born in the U.S., don't really look at it and think, understand that Kwame had been living in Africa for 30 years.
Well, that's a fact, and not only that, Kwame Ture had a global outlook on our situation, which is to which is really the true Pan-Africanists, if they're going to work and fight for the struggle of their people, it doesn't just lie in one particular place. It's a global thing. And I remember Kwame Ture coming back in the 70s that, to my knowledge, he was one of the few Pan-Africanist members at that time that had embraced Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah's total liberation for Africa. I believe they called it, they later called it Nkrumahism.
Nkrumahism.
Okay.
When I first came into the party,
right.
That what it was, is okay. Just Nkrumahism.
Right. And we in the New York area, who were Garveyites, embraced that same philosophy because it was both, they say the same. But Kwame Ture demonstrated, you know, by going to Africa, and I would never say that he ran to Africa, unless, you know, if you ran into the gold mines, I would say that. But by him going to Africa, gave him that much more credibility in the fight and the struggle that he was engaged in for the freedom of his people. Because if any place, the continent, especially at that time with Kwame Nkrumah and Ture, they had the balance of the knowledge that we needed to know to move forward on that level. So, you know, to those who say that he ran, I would say that no, he advanced. You know, he just went to a different level.
I just think about when you made the comment about where he wouldn't run into the gold mine. You know, I thought about when I was there in Guinea with his mama. You know, we was mm-hmm. me and I was sitting there and talking. You know, and she was saying that, well, you know, Brother Yambu, I wasn't a rich woman. I wasn't a poor woman, but I was always able to buy Kwame clothes to send him to school.
You're right.
And she said Kwame will always give away the new clothes and wear the worst clothes because he didn't want none of the people to think that he was better than them.
Oh, great.
He was one of the brothers in Guinea who was a member of the People's Democratic Party of Guinea,
mm-hmm.
and who was the governor there. And he said that him and Kwame used to go out throughout Guinea there in the different regions there, and he would always give Kwame the best room.
Right.
You know, and said Kwame, you know, didn't know it. So when they went to the second place, he still gave Kwame the best room, and Kwame didn't know it. So the next time they did it, Kwame went and checked the rooms. You understand? And come to find out that he was giving Kwame the best room.
Right.
You know, he said that's the only problem him and Kwame ever had, because Kwame said, no, you have the best room, I have the lesser room. You understand? You know, he was talking about how Kwame always put himself behind the people, beside the people, and in front of the people, that he would never, you know, want to be a bourgeois mm-hmm. among the people, you know. And that's what I think people throughout the world understand that about Kwame, not just African people, but other people, that Kwame raised the level of consciousness of Africans and non-African people's struggle, of other people struggling, other organizations, other people in other parts of the world struggle, who come to give Kwame great dedication throughout his life and for the rest of his life. You know?
Right. Well, now you just returned from Guinea.
Yes.
At the funeral, and so you can tell us the outpouring, and first of all, the representatives that was there. I understand that you had some representatives there from Ghana, Cuba, Libya, where else?
PLO, Mali, Iran, Iraq, from Trinidad, St. Kitts, Barbados, Jamaica.
Okay.
People came from all over, ambassadors and representatives from different organizations.
Who's outpouring with the people of Guinea? I mean,
many people came to Kwame's funeral in Guinea, mm-hmm. even with the sabotage.
Sabotage?
Yeah, even with the sabotage. They went on there during the whole death thing,
I'm not surprised, but
by the CIA, also by the government there, and dealing with communications and no phone calls in and out of the countries, and communication and dealing with the press, and putting flies and things up. We understand that Kwame always said, well, if you ain't fighting for your people's liberation, then you don't have to worry about the CIA.
But
if you're struggling for your people, you always got to worry about it. And he said, long as I live, you don't always have to worry about him. And we know, even at his death, that they would still be trying to make some kind of bad remarks towards Kwame Ture. Right. But we know that the African masses throughout the world and other peace-loving people throughout the world know that they could never do that. They know that Kwame Ture was incorruptible.
But now, this is something that I would like for you to let our listeners know, our viewers know, is how do people of Guinea and the world view him in his, like you say, in his honesty towards our struggle, and how he was able to articulate, the feelings of African people here to others around the world, with the outpouring. Was it, I would assume that it was a very large feeling.
Yeah, it was a pretty large funeral. I'd say maybe we used about 700-800 people at Kwame's funeral in Guinea. Mm-hmm. It was probably more people at the memorial service for Kwame in New York, which was on the same day of November 22nd.
Right.
Which is also a historical day that
Kwame
will probably be tried to die or be buried on that day, because November the 22nd was the day that the Portuguese again attacked Guinea.
Okay.
On this day,
right.
So Kwame, was on planning a trip to go to Libya on an embargo protest against the U.S. embargo against Libya and Iran and Iraq and Cuba.
Mm-hmm.
So even on his dying bed, Kwame was still fighting against imperialism. We know him. Kwame was in the hospital in New York. When he got out in his wheelchair, he went down and started demonstrating his wheelchair with the people who was fighting against the capitalist system there for high wages, even.
Okay. Aquaba to Insight. We have a call coming in. Aquaba to Insight. Hello? We can't hear you in here.
Hello?
Hello. Welcome to Insight.
Can you hear me?
Aquaba.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I got one comment. Instead of saying you went to Africa, why don't we say you went back home?
Africa is home.
No, why? He went back home.
Yeah, he went home. No.
Not just to Africa. He went home.
Yeah, he went home.
After he's an African, and Africa is his home.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.
But he went back home.
Sure.
Right.
Well, then all of us should go back home.
Ain't no doubt about it.
Okay. Matter of fact,
I used to have this big flag in my house, my brother. Used to say, take your funk to Africa before you die. So every time I saw Kwame, he would say, all right, take your funk to Africa before you die. But one of the things that I know Kwame Ture was going to do, if nothing else, he was going to make sure that he died in Africa. We know that Kwame could have stayed in the U.S., probably lived a little longer. But Kwame know it was going to be a political question for him to die at home in Africa. We know that Kwame Nkrumah, not Secretary Ture, died at home in Africa. But Kwame was going to die at home in Africa. We know that.
Right. Well,
it'll clip a lot of confusion about the question of even identity. You understand? Because we have, our party have always pushed, we're African, nothing but Africa. We are Africans, just a number of Africans, you understand?
Right.
And even today, even Africans have to say, they are African American, you understand? But one day, they'll get to that high level, they just cut off America, and they understand they were African, period. So, right. We're all Africans, must return back to home.
Good. Aquaba to Insight. Welcome to Insight.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi, I'm a young man in Atlanta, Georgia, and I got a comment about African Americans. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, today, my opinion is African Americans have really lost the barrier. What I mean by the barrier, they have lost their morals, the history of who they are and knowing who they are. And see, we as black African Americans, we don't pull together, and everybody know. Ain't no sense of playing games. We know that we live in a society where computers are taking over and anything can go down. These are the 90s. Let's face it, it's not the 60s no more, where Mr. Nice Guy. Now it's all about, you know, you got to do your thing, you know, to survive. I mean, no one cares, okay? So when we say African Americans, we really need to think, really, because it's deep than what I think as a young man. It's deeper than what it really it is, you know, as far as African American. We have to come together. We have to be a group of people to function and learn how to come together. And I want to ask you something. Why are more black African-American women are turning gay?
Capitalism. I tell you, capitalism, imperialism.